Thank you. Thank you. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Bishop of the Church of God, the clergy and people of the Diocese of New York, trusting in the guidance of the Holy Spirit, have chosen Matthew Foster Heyd to be a bishop and chief pastor. We therefore ask you to lay your hands upon him and in the power of the Holy Spirit to consecrate him a bishop in the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church.
Let the testimony of your life be read.
The certificate of election. This is to certify that a convention of the Church in the Diocese of New York, duly called in accordance with the Constitution and canons of the said diocese, assembled in person here at the Cathedral of St. John the Divine, New York, New York, on December 3rd, 2022. The Reverend Matthew Foster Heyd, being at least 30 years of age, was duly elected by a constitutional majority consistent with the Constitution and canons of the Diocese of New York, and all requirements of the Constitution of the Episcopal Church have been complied with. In witness whereof, we, the Right Reverend Andrew M. L. Deechy, President of the said convention, and the Reverend Catherine Flexer, Secretary thereof, have hereunto set our hands and caused the seal of the diocese to be affixed this 3rd of December, 2022.
Testimonial of election of a bishop. We, whose names are here underwritten, fully sensible of how important it is that the sacred order and office of a bishop should not unworthily be conferred, and firmly persuaded that it is our duty to bear testimony on this solemn occasion without partiality, do, in the presence of Almighty God, testify that we know of no impediment on account of which the Reverend Matthew Foster Heyd ought not to be ordained to that holy office. We do moreover jointly and severally declare that we believe the Reverend Matthew Foster Heyd to have been duly and lawfully elected and to be of such sufficiency in learning, of such soundness in the faith, and of such godly character as to be able to exercise the office of a bishop to the honor of God and the edifying of the church, and to be a wholesome example to the flock of Christ. The Reverend Sam Owen, President of the Standing Committee, December 3rd, 2022, I hereby certify that the above canonical testimony was signed by a constitutional majority of the convention of the Diocese of New York, meeting in session in person at the Cathedral of St. John the Divine, New York, New York, on the 3rd day of December, 2022, the Reverend Catherine G. Flexer, Secretary of Convention.
Certificate of Ordination. This is to certify that according to the Recorder of Ordinations, Matthew Foster Heyd, was ordained to the diaconate on March 7, 2009 by Bishop Mark Sean Sisk at the Cathedral of St. John the Divine, New York, New York, and to the priesthood on September 12, 2009 by Bishop Mark Sean Sisk at the Cathedral of St. John the Divine, New York, New York. Signed, Amalia Afan Santos of the Church Pension Fund, in his capacity as Recorder of Ordinations.
Certificate of Consents, Standing Committees. I hereby certify that consents have been received from the standing committees of 68 dioceses to the ordination and consecration of the Reverend Matthew Foster Hyde to be Bishop Coadjutor of the Diocese of New York. Sam Owen, President of the Standing Committee.
Testimonial from the bishops pertaining to the ordination and consecration of the Bishop Coadjutor of New York. Be it known by all the people of God that 93 bishops, being a majority of the bishops having jurisdiction in this church, have consented to the ordination and consecration of Matthew Foster Hyde as a bishop in the Church of God and to his status in the House of Bishops as Bishop Coadjutor of New York, being the 1,156th bishop in the American succession. Signed, Diane M. Jardine Bruce, Secretary, House of Bishops.
My brother, please make your declaration.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, I, Matthew Foster Hyde, chosen Bishop of the Church in New York, solemnly declare that I do believe the Holy Scriptures, the Old and New Testaments, to be the Word of God, and to contain all things necessary to salvation. And I do solemnly engage to conform to the doctrine, discipline, and worship of the Episcopal Church.
brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus. You have heard testimony given that Matthew Foster Heyd has been duly and lawfully elected to be a bishop of the Church of God to serve in the Diocese of New York. You have been assured of his suitability and that the Church has approved him for this sacred responsibility. Nevertheless, if any of you know any reason why we should not proceed, let it now be made known. Is it your will that we ordain Matthew a bishop? Will you uphold Matthew as bishop?
We will.
The Holy Scriptures tell us that our Savior Christ spent the whole night in prayer before he chose and sent forth his 12 apostles. Likewise, the apostles prayed before they anointed Matthias to be one of their number. Let us, therefore, follow their examples and offer our prayers to Almighty God before we ordain Matthew for the work to which we trust the Holy Spirit has called him.
Yeah.
para que en testimonio fiel proclame el Evangelio hasta los confines de la tierra. Te suplicamos, oh Señor. Para que reciban la luz del Evangelio, te suplicamos, oh Señor, por la paz del mundo, para que entre las naciones y los pueblos crezca un espíritu de respeto y comprensión, te suplicamos, oh Señor. Para que el mundo sea librado de la pobreza, el hambre y el desastre. Te suplicamos, oh Señor,
Señor, atiende nuestra súplica.
Por las personas pobres, perseguidas, enfermas, y quienes sufrimos, por las personas refugiadas, prisioneras, y por quienes están en mucho peligro, para que haya protección. Te suplicamos, oh Señor,
Señor, atiende nuestra súplica.
Por nosotros, por el perdón de nuestros pecados y por la gracia del Espíritu Santo para enmendar nuestras vidas. Te suplicamos, oh Señor,
Señor, atiende nuestra súplica.
Por quienes han muerto en la comunión de tu iglesia, y por quienes cuya fe solo tú conoces, para que con tus santos y santas tengan descanso en ese lugar donde no hay dolor ni tristeza, sino vida eterna. Te suplicamos, oh Señor,
Señor, atiende nuestra súplica.
Gozándonos en la comunión de la siempre bendita Guadalupe, del bienaventurado San Juan el teólogo y todos los santos, todas las santas, encomendémonos mutuamente y toda nuestra vida a Cristo nuestro Dios, a ti Señor
nuestro Dios.
Señor, ten piedad,
Cristo.
Let us pray. O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the book of Prophet Isaiah. 주 야훼의 영을 내려주시며 야훼께서 나에게 기름을 부어주시고 나를 보내시며 이르셨다. 억눌린 자들에게 복음을 전하여라. 찢긴 마음을 싸매주고 포로들에게 해방을 알려라. 옥에 갇힌 자들에게 자유를 선포하여라. 야훼께서 우리를 반겨주실 해, 우리 하느님께서 원수 갚으실 날이 이르렀다고 선포하여라. 슬퍼하는 모든 사람들을 위로하여라. 시온에서 슬퍼하는 사람에게 희망을 주어라. 재를 뒤집어썼던 사람에게 빛나는 관을 씌워주어라. 상복을 입었던 몸에 기쁨의 기름을 발라주어라. 침울한 마음에서 찬양이 울려 퍼지게 하여라. 그들의 이름하여 정의의 느티나무 숲이라 하여라. 야훼가 자기의 자랑거리로 손수 심은 것, 그들은 옛 생터를 재건하고 오래전에 허물어진 폐허를 다시 세우리라. 무너진 도시들을 새로 세우고 그 옛날 선조 때 헐린 집들을 선축하리라. 뜨내기들이 모여들어 너희의 양을 치고 외국인들이 너희의 농장과 포도원에서 일하리라. 그들이 너희를 야훼의 사제들이라 부르고 우리 하느님의 봉사자라 불러주리라. 너희는 다른 민족들의 재물을 먹고 그들의 보물로 단장하리라. 이스라엘은 갑절이나 수치를 받았고 능력밖에는 돌아온 처지가 없었으므로 이제 저희 땅에서 받을 상속은 갑절이나 되고 누릴 기쁨은 영원하리라. 나 야훼는 공평을 좋아하고 약탈과 부정을 싫어한다. 나는 그들에게 고생한 대가를 어김없이 갚아주며 영원한 계약을 그들과 맺으리라. The word of the Lord.
None who look to you be put to shame. Let the treacherous be disappointed in the schemes.
Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths.
Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you God of my salvation. In you have I trusted all the day long.
Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting.
Remember not
that the sins of my youth and my transgressions, remember me according to your love, and for the sake of your goodness, O Lord.
Out of my time. in Lektüre. Une lecture de la deuxième lettre de Paul aux chrétiens. Cette assurance-là, nous l'avons par Christ auprès de Dieu. Ce n'est pas à dire que nous soyons par nous-mêmes capables de concevoir quelque chose comme venant de nous-mêmes. Notre capacité, au contraire, vient de Dieu. Il nous a aussi rendus capables d'être ministres d'une nouvelle alliance, non de la lettre, mais de l'esprit. Car la lettre tue, mais l'esprit vivifie. Or, si le ministère de la mort, gravé des lettres sur les pierres, a été glorieux, au point que le fils d'Israël ne pouvait fixer les regards sur le visage de Moïse, à cause de la gloire de son visage, bien que cette gloire fût passagère, combien le ministère de l'Esprit ne sera-t-il pas plus glorieux? Si le ministère de la condamnation a été glorieux, le ministère de la justice est de beaucoup supérieur en gloire. The word of the Lord.
Santo Evangelio de nuestro Señor Jesucristo, según San Juan. Después de decirle estas cosas, Jesús miró al cielo y dijo: Padre, la hora ha llegado. Glorifica a tu Hijo, para que también Él te glorifique a ti. Pues tú has dado a tu Hijo autoridad sobre todo hombre, para dar vida eterna a todo lo que le diste. Y la vida eterna consiste en que te conozcan a ti, el único Dios verdadero, y a Jesucristo, a quien tú enviaste. Yo te he glorificado aquí en el mundo, pues he terminado la obra que tú me confiaste. Ahora pues, Padre, dame en tu presencia la misma gloria que yo tenía contigo desde antes que existiera el mundo. A lo que escogiste del mundo para dármelos, les he hecho saber quién eres. Eran tuyos y tú me lo diste. Han hecho caso de tu palabra. Ahora saben que todo lo que tú me diste viene de ti, pues les ha dado el mensaje que me diste y ellos los han aceptado. Se han dado cuenta de que en verdad he venido de ti y han creído en que tú me enviaste. Yo te ruego por ellos. No ruego por los que son del mundo, sino por lo que me diste, porque son tuyos. Como me enviaste a mí entre los que son del mundo, también yo los envío a ellos entre los que son del mundo. Y por causa de ello me consagro a mí mismo, para que también ellos sean consagrados por medio de la verdad. No te ruego solamente por estos, sino también por lo que se han de creer en mí al oír el mensaje de ellos. Te pido que todos ellos estén unidos para que tú, Padre, estés en mí y yo en ti. También ellos están en nosotros para que el mundo crea que tú me enviaste.
After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you and the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me. And they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you. For the words that you gave me, I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I came from you. And they have believed that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I am not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. As you have sent me into the world, So I have sent them into the world. And for their sake, I sanctified myself, so that they may also be sanctified in truth. I ask, not only on behalf of these, but also on behalf of those who believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, as you, Father, are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The Gospel. The Gospel of the Lord.
Yes. Let us pray. Come by here, Lord, come by here, so that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. For you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Amen. Good morning, Cathedral Church.
Good morning.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Gathered on this day to coming together to ordain yet another bishop in our church, friend to us all, brother and colleague to me, Bishop elect, but not for so long, Matthew Foster Boyd. And so as it is that we gather on this day, we must ask ourselves, what does it mean to lead God's church in this our time? For ours is a time still marked by the intersecting realities of the three crises that we have faced over the last several years. The health crises, that is the pandemic of COVID. The social justice crises, that is the pandemic of anti-black white racism. And the political crises, that is unprincipled authority and unbridled arrogance. What does it mean to lead the church in such a time that is ours? For ours is a time where bigotry and xenophobia are becoming standard practices. Ours is a time when brutality, inhumanity, and death visited upon the helpless and the homeless, the marginalized and the minoritized, outsiders and outcasts, has become all but routine. Ours is a time when returning to a cruel and unjust past and protecting a corrupt and unprincipled present has become virtually a rallying cry. And yes, ours is a time when deceit and licentiousness have become all but a badge of honor. And so it is that we must ask on this day, what does it mean to lead God's church in such a time that is ours? Now, the answer to this question is embedded within our various readings this morning, as they all in some way speak about the one who is called to lead. And so, what is it that we find in these readings? What is it that they tell us about what it means to lead God's church in this our time? We find in John these words, as Jesus prays his last prayer for his disciples to God. He says this, "They were yours, and you gave them to me." They were yours. What does it mean to lead God's church in this our times? It means being the children of God that we were created to be. For you see, church, each and every one of us who is created by God, and that's everyone who has breath or has ever had breath, each and every one of us is a child of God. That's a fact. And so it is that coursing through our very being is the divine DNA, the stuff of which our souls are made of, the stuff that animates and propels us to be better, to do better, to push beyond our flawed humanity, to live into that which God has created us to be, to live into the more of who we are as God's children. And that, my friends, begins with treating everyone the way we would expect to be treated as children of God. And that is with dignity, respect, care, kindness, in a word, with the love that is God's for us. The point of the matter is that God loved us into life as God's children. And so it is for us to act as the loved children that we are by loving one another as God has so loved us. Cathedral, today, there are 11 million children living in poverty, including 1 in 6 who are under the age of 5. And almost half of all other children are living in extreme poverty. They are children of God's all. And so we, as children of God, are created to be and to do better than that. Better than letting our children live in poverty. That they do reflects our flawed humanity, not the more of who we are created to be. And so what does it mean for us to lead in God's church in this time that is ours? It means acting like the more of who we are, acting like children of God. And it means being compassionate. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives and release to the prisoners. What does it mean to lead God's church in this our time? It means being compassionate, as Jesus shows us to be, which means nothing less than entering into compassionate solidarity with those who are trapped in unjust social realities of suffering. Such is the way of Jesus. For that he died on the cross is a testament to his compassionate solidarity for the suffering classes of people in his own time. Now, let me be clear. Such compassionate solidarity is not a call for us to suffer, as if suffering itself is redemptive. No, rather it is a call for us to feel deeply in our hearts, to feel deeply the hurts, the pains, the yearnings, the strivings, and the struggles of those who are trapped in the realities of suffering, so that our hearts may be filled with the compassion that is Jesus, making it intolerable for us to tolerate a world that creates such suffering. This week, an 8-year-old girl from Panama, who was traveling with her father, mother, and 2 siblings looking for refuge, died in a border control, where she was in border control custody. This week, even as others are being scattered from state to state, from hotel to hotel, from school gym to school gym, because there is no room for them to find a safe place to lay their heads. Another boy from Latin America died in custody. We are people with a heart, so we have the capacity to do better than that. We have the capacity to be compassionate in the way that Jesus has shown us to be. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor, to heal the brokenhearted, as Jesus quotes Isaiah in his first public address. What does it mean to lead God's church in this time that is ours? It means that those of us with a beating heart must be compassionate the way in which Jesus shows us to be. And it means to conspire. That is, to join with another to make something that is difficult come to be. He has made us competent as ministers of a new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit, for the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. Paul calls those who would lead God's church not to follow the ways of the world, the ways of that foster death, but to follow and thus to conspire with the Spirit of God that is moving through our world, the Spirit that fosters the abundance for life that God promises us all. And here is the thing. Every time we take a breath, we are inhaling what we need to conspire with the Spirit that is God's coursing through our time, so that we can join with God in making real in this our time at least a glimpse of God's future, where no one is deprived of the abundance they need to live and to thrive. If we breathe, then we have no excuse for not conspiring with God to create a more just future where all God's people can be free from that which would indeed deny their very sacred breath of life. So far this year, there have been 202 mass shootings, more mass shootings than days that we have gone in our 2023 calendar. And as of May 1st, at least 13,959 people have died from gun violence, 491 of whom were teens, 88 of who were children. Yet, there has been no outcry loud enough to do something about guns in this country. We can do better than this because we have what we need. We have what we need. Every time we breathe, to conspire with God to create a world where not one more life will be taken by the ridiculousness that is God's. And so, and so there you have it. To lead in God's church in this time that is ours means to be the children of God who God loved us into being. It means being compassionate as Jesus showed us how to be. And it means to conspire as the Spirit leads us to be. And so what? Why am I talking about this on this day? Well, here is the thing that becomes clearer and clearer to me with each passing day. And that is, borrowing from the words of Martin Luther King Jr., there is a fierce urgency of now for the church to be church. And that begins in this time that is ours with those who have been called to lead God's church in this, our time. And this brings me to our soon-to-be ordained bishop, Matt. Not long after I became dean of EDS at Union, I was told by various people that you need to meet Matt Heyd. You need to meet the rector of Heavenly Rest. And so, always listening to wise advice, a lunch meeting was arranged for me to meet with Matt Heyd. And so we met at Bastici's down the street from Union. Now, if you know Bastici's, you know that if you were seated by the window, you can see folks as they are coming into the restaurant. And so as I was seated by the window, I saw Matt, I knew it was him because he had on a collar, entering the restaurant with his colleague, Anne Marie. And as I saw him, I thought to myself, you've got to be kidding.
this has got to be a joke. For here comes this white man bounding down the steps, and I gotta admit, reminding me of Opie from the Andy Griffith Show. And then, when he came in, you know, always smiling and always cheerful, and said hello with his North Carolina accent, I thought to myself, OMG, it is Opie. I could not figure out why I was told that I had to meet Matt. Well, it didn't take me long to know why. For Matt immediately exuded what it meant to be a child of God, and he treated me as such as well. He instinctively revealed the compassion of one with a big heart. And it wasn't long that with the breath he took to talk, there we were conspiring with how to come together to create and foster a more just future. The one that I thought looked like Opie became very quickly my brother from another mother. And so, Matt, my brother, as you enter into the episcopacy, continue to be the child of God that you are. Continue to listen to your beating heart and foster the kind of compassion that Jesus shows us. And continue to use each breath you breathe to conspire with the spirit that is God moving in the world to indeed foster a more just future. And if you do this, then you will be church every time you show up in the world. And as it is for Matt, it is to be for us also. For anyone in this place that is a child of God, and that's everyone, and anyone in this place who has a beating heart, and that's everyone, and anyone in this place that has breath to breathe, and that's everyone, is called to be that child of God in the world, is called to be compassionate, is called to conspire with the Spirit of God that is moving through the world, is called to be church in the world. What does it mean to lead the church that is God's in this our time? It means to be church, to be church, to be the children of God that we are with compassion and breath to conspire. Matt, be church. Cathedral, be church. Let us leave this place responding to the fierce urgency of now to be God's church in the world. May it be so. Amen.
Brother, the people have chosen you and have affirmed their trust in you by acclaiming your election. A bishop in God's holy church is called to be one with the apostles in proclaiming Christ's resurrection and interpreting the gospel, and to testify to Christ's sovereignty as Lord of Lords and King of Kings. You are called to guard the faith, unity, and discipline of the church, to celebrate and to provide for the administration of the sacraments of the new covenant, to ordain priests and deacons, and to join in ordaining bishops, and to be in all things a faithful pastor and wholesome example for the entire flock of Christ. With your fellow bishops, you will share in the leadership of the church throughout the world. Your heritage is the faith of matriarchs and patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and those of every generation who have looked to God in hope. Your joy will be to follow him who came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. My brother, are you persuaded that God has called you to the office of bishop?
I am so persuaded.
Will you accept this call and fulfill this trust in obedience to Christ?
I will obey Christ and will serve in his name.
Will you be faithful in prayer and in the study of Holy Scriptures, that you may have the mind of Christ?
I will, for he is my help.
Will you boldly proclaim and interpret the gospel of Christ, enlightening the minds and stirring up the conscience of your people?
I will, in the power of the Spirit.
As the chief priest and pastor, will you encourage and support all baptized people in their gifts and ministries? Nourish them from the riches of God's grace. Pray for them without ceasing, and celebrate with them the sacraments of our redemption.
I will, in the name of Christ. the shepherd and bishop of our souls.
Will you guard the faith, unity, and discipline of the church?
I will, for the love of God.
Will you share with your fellow bishops in the government of the whole church? Will you sustain your fellow presbyters and take counsel with them? Will you guide and strengthen the deacons and all others who minister in the church?
I will, by the grace given me.
Will you be merciful to all, show compassion to the poor and strangers, and defend those who have no helper?
I will, for the sake of Christ Jesus.
Matthew, through the promises you have committed, these promises you have committed yourself to God to serve his church in the office of bishop. We therefore call upon you, chosen to be a guardian of the church's faith, to lead us in confessing that faith.
We believe in one God.
We believe in one God.
The Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Thank you.
God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Father of mercies and God of all comfort, dwelling on high but having regard for the lowly, knowing all things before they come to pass, we give you thanks that from the beginning you have gathered and prepared a people to be heirs of the covenant of Abraham and have raised up prophets, kings, and priests, never leaving your temple untended. We praise you also that from the creation you have graciously accepted the ministry of those whom you have chosen. Therefore, Father, make Matthew a bishop in your church. Pour out upon him the power of your princely spirit, whom you bestowed upon your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, with whom he endowed the apostles, and by whom your church is built up in every place, to the glory and unceasing praise of your name. To you, O Father, all hearts are open. We pray the heart of this your servant, whom you have chosen to be a bishop in your church, filled with such love of you and of all the people, that he may feed and tend the flock of Christ and exercise without reproach the high priesthood to which you have called him, serving before you day and night in the ministry of reconciliation, declaring pardon in your name, offering the holy gifts, and wisely overseeing the life and work of the church. In all things, may he present before you the acceptable offering of a pure and gentle and holy life, through Jesus Christ, your Son, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be honor and power and glory in the church, now and forever.
Amen.
Matthew, receive the Holy Scriptures. Feed the flock of Christ committed to your charge. Guard and defend them in his truth. And be a faithful steward of God's holy word and sacraments. Hold on, New York, hold on. Come on. New York, greet your Bishop Coadjutor and his family.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Also with you.
Offer each other a sign of peace. I love you. So, help me thank our preacher, Dean Kelly Brown Douglas. Prophet, theologian, friend, sister, but oh my goodness, Opie? It's only funny because it's true. Help me thank our consecration co-chairs who have done so much work to make this day possible. Susan Fortunato, Deacon Hyacinth Lee, and Anne-Marie Wichker, I'm grateful for their work and the work of everyone who organized for this day and this weekend. And I am grateful to Bishop Andy Deechy, from whom I will learn and work over this next transition year. Grateful for our church across generations. Today is a day of community consecration. We've come through so much. There's been such struggle. 3 long years of the pandemic, the struggle to dismantle white supremacy, misogyny, our tangled history. There's been so much struggle to come through. And we are followers of Jesus Christ. And the presiding bishop has said, we are being reinvented by the Holy Spirit. In the examination he just gave, the prayer book says, our heritage is the faith of matriarchs and patriarchs, prophets, apostles, and martyrs, and all those in every generation who turn to God in hope. And to serve is our joy. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ. So what could we do, you and I, if we weren't afraid? If we cared for each other through hard times and doing hard things together? What could we do if we knew that God sanctified our struggles? If we found resurrection in our struggles? If we lived in hope and served together in joy? This is the good news of the church in this and all seasons. This is the good news of Jesus Christ. Here's the bad news. I don't know how to be bishop yet. But we're all created as channels of God's grace. And you've brought me this far. I am completely confident that we can do this together. The world needs a gospel that is bright and bold and clear. The world needs us in all of our communities, from Northern Dutchess to the South Shore of Staten Island. We build communities of love where we see everyone as children of God. And we speak up, stand up, speak out against injustice. We are the Episcopal Diocese of New York, and this is what we do. Our story at this time, God's story in us, is the renewal of our church for the healing of the world. We feel and experience the fierce urgency of now. We are Easter people. We are made for renewal. I'm confident we can do this together because this is our time. Thank you. And now, beloved, because God loves us so much, we also ought to love one another. We love one another. God's love lives in us, and God's love is completed in us.
All of my time to praise my Lord in battle. Master. Keep so busy serving my Master. Keep so busy serving my Master. Ain't got time.
'Cause when I'm giving my all, when I'm giving my all, when I'm giving my all,
ain't got time to die. 'Cause it takes all of my time to praise my Jesus, all of my time to praise my Lord. If I don't praise him, the rock's gonna cry out, glory and honor, glory and honor, ain't got time to die.
Now won't you get out of my way?
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Through the great shepherd of your flock, Jesus Christ our Lord, who after his resurrection sent forth his apostles to preach the gospels and to teach all nations, and promised to be with them always, even to the end of the ages. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. When we had fallen into sin, become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Let us pray. Almighty Father, we thank you for feeding us with the holy food of the body and blood of your Son, and for uniting us through him in the fellowship of your Holy Spirit. We thank you for raising up among us faithful servants for the ministry of your word and sacraments. We pray that Matthew may be to us an effective example in word and action, in love and patience, and in holiness of life.
Grant that we with him may serve you now and always rejoice in your glory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
The maker of heaven and earth.
Blessed be the name of the Lord.
From this time forth forevermore.
The blessing, mercy, and grace of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Let us go forth into the world, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.